This is The Wheelhouse. I'm John Dankosky. Join the conversation on our website, wnpr.org/The Wheelhouse. You can find us on Facebook, Facebook Live, and Twitter at WNPR Wheelhouse. You can call us today, 860-275-7266. It's the day after a very big midterm election day. A lot to talk about, including the brand new news that we do now finally have a new governor of the state of Connecticut. Ned Lamont will be the next governor. Bob Stefanowski called him to concede very, very recently. We'll have more on that in just a moment. But first, I want to welcome in our panelists today, all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, people who have just had lots of sleep, including Colin McEnroe, the host of The Colin McEnroe Show on WNPR. Howdy, Colin.
Good morning, Mr. Dankosky.
Kalila Brown-Dean, Associate Professor of Political Science at Quinnipiac University, who is spending the night very nearby Republicans and also on WFSB Channel 3 last night. Kalila, good to see you.
Good to see you.
And Dan Haar, editor and columnist at Hearst Connecticut Media, a media organization that was temporarily shut out by the Stefanowski campaign. We'll be talking about that later on as well. Danny, welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
Okay, so here's what we have. We might as well start right here. It is 9:06 right now, maybe about 10 minutes or so ago. Bob Stefanowski, the Republican running for governor, he conceded to Ned Lamont. He called Ned Lamont first, and then he called his favorite radio show.
Yeah, well, I wanted to give you guys the first word of this. I just conceded to Ned. Okay. We're going to issue a statement at 9 o'clock, but you and the tribe have been terrific to me. So I thought it was only appropriate I do it on this show.
Wow. So bring us through last night.
Yeah, you know, I went to bed. We were up 20,000 votes. But the last precincts to come in are New Haven and Bridgeport and Hartford, the big cities. And those are largely Democratic. So, you know, it tipped the scales early this morning.
So
not every vote is in yet, but New Haven is still outstanding. But that's probably 4 or 5 to 1 for Ned.
So that's Bob Stefanowski calling on his favorite radio program. You'll note that's not this radio program. That's Chaz and AJ. They're the sort of morning zoo jocks who he's gone on a number of times. He even went on and debated Ned Lamont a couple days ago. Bob Stefanowski concedes defeat.
Right. And I mean, this is connected to a thread we'll be talking about later. Bob Stefanowski's contempt for the working press has been an ongoing issue. I support any decision, any banning decision that involves being upset with Danny. But this is part of the Stefanowski vibe in a way that's sort of Trump light. He doesn't like the press. He doesn't cooperate with the press. He doesn't do what the press wants. And he all the way through thought that was kind of a big strength. Well, how do you like us now? I'm sorry, but I mean, I just thought that part of his campaign was one of the parts that was kind of unprofessional.
Well, it actually connects to something that we'll be talking about as we talk through all the results from last night. Bob Stefanowski needed to do very, very well in rural areas across the state, which he did. Ned Lamont was going to do very well in cities, and we'll be talking about just how incredibly well he did in cities. But then there's the battlegrounds that we've been hearing about all across America, actually, these suburban places, places that aren't necessarily very pro-Donald Trump. You know what suburbanites like, Colin? They like NPR. They actually like Where We Live with Lucy Now Potential. They like to hear from people who have answers for them. They don't necessarily like their candidates only going on, you know, FM radio with a couple of guys who are playing hits in between.
Right. So Stefanowski's the reasons that he was reluctant to cooperate with the conventional working press is because they were going to ask him a lot of questions that he didn't know the answers to or didn't want to give the answers to, whereas it's maybe a little bit easier to bounce through something like this. I guess, you know, as we get set up to talk about this, though, just to maybe set a slightly different tone here, I feel like England has Shakespeare. We have Die Hard movies. And at the end of Die Hard 2, Holly Gennaro McLean, played by Bonnie Bedelia, turns to her husband and says, "Why does this keep happening to us?" And I'm kind of thinking that about Connecticut right now. In 2010, we had an incredibly close election, wasn't decided during the night of the election. A judge had to keep polls open. There were problems with ballots in a city. In 2014, we had another very close election, hard to call it on election night. A judge had to keep polling places open, this time in Hartford, problems with the ability to vote in Hartford polling places. In 2018, we have an incredibly close election, not really decided decided until the following day. Judges had to get involved because of ballot problems and registration problems in New Haven. The degree to which New Haven was a hot mess this time is something that we're going to be still figuring out a couple of days from now, but it was a pretty bad story having to do with Election Day registration and this problem with the wet ballot. So, yeah, I feel like we need new writers, you know? We need new writers. We can't keep having these sequels that are all kind of the same movie. Like, I want a 2022, I want, like, a gubernatorial election that sort of doesn't resemble these last three.
Well, and Kalilah Brandine, here's one of the most interesting things about this. Once again, we have a city, New Haven this time. It's been Bridgeport in the past. It's been Hartford in the past as well. Places where Democrats need to perform. You need to perform well to elect senators, maybe to help elect presidents, certainly to elect governors. And these cities, which are overwhelmingly Democratic, cannot seem to do the very thing that is necessary to allow people to have the franchise of voting. We've been hearing an awful lot of concern about people in places like Georgia being denied access to the ballot. But here in New Haven, people are being denied access, not seemingly through any sort of intimidation at the polls, not seemingly through any sort of large-scale problems that people are throwing up in front of them, just pure and utter incompetence.
So you can't denounce Republican voter suppression in Georgia and then be complicit in it in New Haven, because it is voter suppression. When you have a system that says we allow same-day registration, then you need to have the staffing and the resources to make that run. If not, you have to be clear that you're not really committed to it, because this isn't new. As Colin said, every 2-4 years, we go through this again. New Haven needs to set the standard that if it's committed to participation, it's going to staff it.
Danny?
Well, you can't entirely blame the cities as the narrow end of the funnel here in terms of both population and everything else when you have a system that doesn't allow early voting. And that's, you know, across the country, we've seen record numbers of people voting early. Absentee ballots here nominally are supposed to be with an excuse, and there's no excuse for needing an excuse. And so part of the problem is the electoral reform that we tried to get in, I believe, 2014 that failed, unfortunately, because people didn't realize that it might fail.
But does that excuse, as Kalilah said, only having a few people stationed at City Hall able to register those people for day of registration, does it excuse the fact that ballots are jamming because they're a little moist, because it was raining outside, and we don't actually get a chance to count ballots or have everything work the way it's supposed to work?
I was in Waterbury last night, and according to Colin's theory, Waterbury is due in 2022 to be the nexus of the problems. But because of – I want to give a shout-out to Michelle Cronin, who was the moderator at the polling place where I was at when they closed. And I said, did you have any problem with wet ballots? Did they jam? And she said, no, we brought paper towels and we told people to please dry your hands before voting. And it actually worked. So there, and she's worth a shout out for that. And the problem is that there are little solutions sometimes that work, and that was one.
Please dry your hands before voting.
Yes.
When Denise Merrill was on last night with us, Kalilah, she talked about in the past having high pressure intensity fans that would dry off the ballots after they
were
wet.
She also talked about blow dryers last night.
Yeah, I just think to yourself, my goodness, is this really what we're talking about right now?
This is so ridiculous. Why do I have to tell you to dry your hands before you touch paper? I'm glad that the moderator did, because apparently that doesn't seem like common sense. But this also undermines what people are saying when people are against same-day registration. I am definitely for it. I also am for us having the mechanisms in place to do what we say we're going to do.
You know, since we apparently should be more like Chaz and AJ, maybe Danny would like to dedicate like a Journey song to Michelle Cronin. Back to this issue of voter suppression. I mean, there's sort of voter suppression that's done by intent, viz. Georgia, and sometimes it's done by incompetence or just failing to think stuff through. That's a little bit more the case in New Haven, but it was bad. And if you want to talk about voter suppression, at a certain point yesterday afternoon in City Hall in New Haven, a sign went up. I think it was put up by an alderman that said, if you're not in line by 4 p.m., there's no guarantee we can register you in time to vote. So think about that. You're a student who, and not all these students are feckless Generation Z people who just woke up and suddenly decided they wanted to vote. Some people had problems or found with their absentee ballots back home, or found out at the last minute that they weren't on the rolls. But anyway, if you have Election Day registration, you should be able to register on Election Day. Anyway, imagine that you are told at 3:45 that after a four-hour wait in a series of lines, and according to Carmen Baskoff, Where We Live producer, who was there last night, it was like people were directing people into different lines. People didn't know what line they were in. And then there was like, well, you go sit in this room, this group of you. And there was quite a bit of confusion about what was happening. But after a four-hour wait, you're told, oh, I'm sorry, we just didn't make it. We didn't register you. It may be passive, it may be unintentional, but that's voter suppression. If you show up at 4 o'clock for something you're supposed to be able to do, and at 8 o'clock you still haven't been able to do it, that's a real problem.
So let's turn away from this problem in just a moment here. We will probably get back to this entire issue that happened in New Haven and some of the other problems that we saw at the polls yesterday, and just get to the substance of what exactly happened. We just heard Bob Stefanowski not too long ago talking on Chaz and AJ. He's now giving a speech, and in quotes here, Kalila, Ned's won fair and square. So Ned Lamont, next governor of the state of Connecticut, after a campaign that certainly didn't inspire tons of people. We had Paul Bass from the New Haven Independent last night saying he had thousands of people saying, I am coming to the polls to vote. A lot of people voting for the first time, people very energized. They weren't voting necessarily for Ned Lamont. They were casting votes against Donald Trump. That all said, Ned Lamont's the next governor.
So I think the real challenge is now, what do you do? You can no longer run on the platform of I am anti-Trump, or that Bob is Trump 2.0. You have to really do something. And I think that Lamont inherits a really difficult time. Morale is low in our state. People are concerned about the economy. And I think we saw it last night. People aren't happy with either political party. So now that you're going to have this change in the legislature, Lamont has to put something forward that people can embrace. And I'm not sure that we know yet what that will be.
And we maybe mentioned this already off the top, but just to put a finer point on it, changes in the legislature include Democrats taking firm control of the Senate, Danny, and gaining more seats in the House. So it's not just that Ned Lamont will be able to work with Democrats. He's going to work with more Democrats than even Dan Malloy was able to.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It's going to more closely resemble what we saw in the not-too-distant past. The first lesson for Democrats is that they can't ignore what just happened, and they can't pretend that there wasn't a candidate who got more votes by a long shot than either of Governor Malloy's wins in 2010 and 2014. He got 640,000 votes. The top that Malloy got was 567,000. And there's a lot of anger out there. And so I tweeted already once today that the Democrats need to govern like Republicans, and they really do need to hold the line on spending. Malloy has done that. He's cut spending. He hasn't increased spending. That's a myth.
But to that point, I mean, Dan Malloy cut spending. He went to state employees and he got concessions. He raised taxes, certainly, but he didn't raise taxes as much as many people on the left flank of the party wanted him to. I don't know, Danny. He did that whole thing where you kind of run the state a little bit more like a Republican or a moderate. And what did he get for it? A 24% approval rating.
I think it's up to 28 now, right? So it's
not in your polls.
No, we were down to 16. Yeah. That's right. No, the answer is that regardless of what the polls say and regardless of what the numbers say, you have to do relative to what you might have done. You have to act in a certain way. Now, look, if we get to discussion of the budget, there's almost no way to do this without a tax increase. The tragedy here is that Bob Stefanowski would have had to have a tax increase, and we'll never be able to prove that.
Colin. Yeah, Ned has sort of kind of let it be known in various contexts that he sees himself as a one-term governor, a guy who is going to come in there, make some hard decisions, some decisions that will be unpopular with virtually every sector that gets affected by the decisions. And I would guess also, I mean, in temperament, he's a very different guy from Dan Malloy. And Dan Malloy had many virtues, but one of his great vices, he didn't work and play well with others. He had a hard time getting along with his own party, with his own constitutional officers, with anybody. And I would guess that Ned will put in the room as early as possible not only the Democratic leadership, which is vastly strengthened in the legislature now, particularly Marty Looney in the Senate. I think he'll bring Fasano and Claritas in there too. A, because it's smart to do. You don't, whatever they wind up doing, you don't want sole ownership of it. And in fact, Fasano and Claritas may not want to be in the room because they may not want to own some of the things that have to happen to fix the budget. But my guess is that Lamont is going to try to work out a cooperative model of governance, a cooperative model of making these hard decisions. And one thing that is clear is with the larger majorities that the Democrats enjoy in both chambers, if they don't do something pretty significant to improve this picture in the next 2 years, they'll have a different kind of bloodbath in 2020 than the one that they had. The Republicans had the bloodbath last night.
In Kalilo, that cooperative model, something that we're hearing not just here in Connecticut now, but we're hearing kind of across the country. There's this question about Democrats who took the House, Democrats who won in various places around the country, whether or not they're going to be able to run next to working with Republicans. In a state like Connecticut, it's probably a lot different than many of the other places because it is such a strong blue state. But what do you see that cooperation between Ned Lamont, the legislature, and the Republicans in the legislature who still play a role? What do you see that looking like right now?
So I think Democrats have to tread very carefully here. So I heard a lot last night about all of the policy positions they hope to go through, legalizing recreational marijuana, talking about affordable health care with Medicaid and all of these changes. The race for the next governor starts today. The race for the next legislators start today in terms of if you go too far away from that core and that center, this is going to be a short-lived victory for the Democrats. So they have to work together. And as Colin said, get Republicans in the room to at least say, we have to own this burden, even if you don't want to.
I think the Democrats can go as far as they want on things like casino gambling and marijuana and other issues that affect the budget positively or not at all. The issue is the budget. And personalities matter. The Senate not only lost three seats, but lost three of the most conservative members of the Senate. One, Joe Markley, who wasn't running, obviously, because he was lieutenant governor.
But replaced by a very conservative guy, too. Samson isn't going to be any different.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Fair enough. But some others, Susio from Meriden and McLaughlin from Danbury area are very conservative people. So, the mix does matter. And I don't think there's a danger in going towards things that are either socially liberal or fiscally kind of weird. There's a problem with that.
I think there's a danger if you want to get reelected or if you want to actually show that you're going to move the state budget and the state economy forward in a long-term way. Republicans play the long game. Democrats like short wins that don't really amount to power.
I just want to say, Colin, our friend Greg Butler sent us a note just now. After what I said, Governor Malloy governed like a Republican, multi-billion-dollar tax increases. Well, first of all, I was making a little bit of a hyperbolic point to talk to Danny. But my point, Colin, of that is Dan Malloy got hit on both ends with all the things that he did. He raised taxes, and nobody liked that, and that's what Bob Stefanowski almost won on. He also didn't raise taxes on some of the people that a whole bunch of the coalition on the left hand of the party wanted him to raise taxes on. He went after state employee unions for some concessions, which didn't make some people happy, but he didn't get enough concessions out of those people to actually fill the hole. He didn't necessarily govern like a Republican, but he didn't govern like a liberal Democrat, as he's been painted in the national and certainly the local media.
I think that's a fair description. I want to go back to something Kalilah said because it's really important. I think, first of all, that she's 100% right. That this election cycle basically begins tomorrow, the next election. But I also feel like that's terrible. In other words, for the second thing that Kalilah said, which is that Democrats often think in terms of very short cycles. So the way not to fix this is to see it as this electoral problem in 2020, because then you're going to make short-sighted, craven, highly political choices. And so that's a little bit worrying to me. If the Democrats kind of see this as something where they have to come up with something that will be sufficiently pleasing, as opposed to sufficiently smart. Even Stefanowski, ultimately decided, realized that this was not a problem that he could fix with a magic wand. You know, his subsequent ways of describing what his fiscal policies were involved no actual tax cuts to the state income tax at all in the first 2 years. So Stefanowski ultimately came to see this problem as a longer problem that needed a longer game to fix the problem.
That's an illustration of the fact that Stefanowski probably went too far in the original promise, too far and for too long. I talked to a voter last night, again in Waterbury. It was a great place to be. That who said, you know, it looked like he was going to cut taxes, but then it came out that he wasn't going to do anything for 2 years, and I guess I just didn't think he had a plan, so I voted for Lamont. And this was a guy who was angry about taxes. And so in this case, it appears that he might have gone too far with the full-on promise of retiring that income tax.
We're going to take a break. We're talking with Dan Haar, editor and columnist at Hearst, Connecticut Media. Hearst, Connecticut Media, maybe we'll be in good graces with the next governor. We don't know. We'll talk more about that in a little bit. Kalila Brown-Dean, associate professor of political science at Quinnipiac University. Everybody loves Kalila Brown-Dean. There's not a question there. And Colin McEnroe, host of the Colin McEnroe Show on WNPR. This is The Wheelhouse on the day after Election Day 2018. This is The Wheelhouse. I'm John Dankosky. You can join our conversation at WNPR.org/The Wheelhouse. You can call us at 860-275-7266. We're pulling apart some of the results from last night. The big result is Ned Lamont is going to be the next governor of the state of Connecticut, and he's going to be working with bigger majorities of Democrats in both houses of the state legislature. We're going to get to some of the other races in just a little bit. We're talking with Dan Haar from Hearst, Connecticut Media, Kalila Brown-Dean from Quinnipiac University, and our own Colin McEnroe. What's on your show today, Colin?
It's funny that you should ask, but I think what we're going to do...
I do that every time, every week at exactly this time, just so you know.
I know, but you hadn't even thought, since I've been on the air a lot, that we might put a rerun on the air so I could catch my breath, but I feel as though the upheavals here are so significant that I want to do a show about this today. We're talking about maybe doing kind of the class of 2018, bringing on particularly some of these surprise winners like Will Haskell, the 22-year-old guy. We don't have these people booked. I'm just saying their names.
Well,
the
maybe they're listening right now, and they can call up.
Will Haskell, the 22-year-old Democrat who beat Tony Boucher, who was a 22-year veteran of the Connecticut General Assembly. Maybe Christine Palm, who's upset a Connecticut River Valley incumbent Republican. I think we want to have maybe Will Haskell if we can get him, and then some of the women. This was a big year in the General Assembly for women, for Democratic women candidates. That's the way it looked going in, and it's one of the things that actually turned out last night the way that it looked.
So that should be a good show this afternoon. Kalila, this tracks across the country. This isn't just in the State House here in Connecticut. It happened with mostly Democratic women across America, but also some Republican women as well. We talk about the Year of the Woman, more people getting involved this year. What do you see in all these victories?
What I think is fantastic is if we look across the country, it really breaks down this view of the monolithic woman candidate or voter. You have women who are veterans. You have women who are educators and have made the transition to public office. But you're also seeing women breaking multiple barriers. The fact that we will now have our first two American Indian women in Congress, our first two Muslim women in Congress, says a lot about the changing demographics that some people see as progress and other people see as fear and as a threat.
There were also some high-profile women who lost their seats across the country as well. So it isn't just about women. It's about women who are maybe showing up with a new face, with a new bit of energy. This is something, you know, that people are hearing. I guess I'm wondering what that says about, you know, somebody who was on the podium last night celebrating the victory, Nancy Pelosi. That's somebody who I think a lot of Republicans have had on their message board that they can run against for the next couple of years. And here she is leading from her same speakership.
I think if the president takes any victory away from last night, it is that he can now have Nancy Pelosi be his chief target in the House, right? So he's run out of nicknames for Paul Ryan. Now he can redirect that in some ways to Nancy Pelosi. But it's also about the Democratic Party taking an introspective look to see if we want to capture young voters, voters of color across the country in the next election, is this the leader that we need to have?
Are any of the things that we're seeing here in Connecticut, Dan, that we've been talking about so far, do you see them playing out in the results across the rest of the country, or was Connecticut very specifically Connecticut?
Well, it's moved a little bit, and that's what I was starting to say before. we wouldn't have, in true blue Connecticut, we wouldn't have seen anything close to the type of excitement that we saw with Bob Stefanowski's message that was essentially anti-government. This is a state that has essentially prided itself on debating how exactly we should go about these community values, not whether they should exist at all in relation to taxes. So, we've moved, but, the danger is that we're an outlier, and it is true that people are leaving the state, and we need to listen to why they're leaving and not just say, nah, we won.
I would differ with that a little bit. I think one thing that we kind of see consistently is that this large group that is not a bloc, the largest group are unaffiliated voters. And what seems to have happened in the last three cycles is a lot of unaffiliated voters have looked at the governor's office and said, we're not really sure we want a Democrat in that job. These have been incredibly close elections. They've been close because unaffiliated voters have certainly expressed, some of them have been very interested in maybe some kind of divided government. And it seems even truer last night. I mean, if in fact Lamont's totals are tracking, you know, much closer than these blowouts that we were seeing in the legislative races, it suggests to me that there were a lot of unaffiliated voters who said, you know what, I like that woman candidate in New Canaan, that Democratic woman candidate in New Canaan. Think about that for a second. I like this person here. I like that person here, and I'm a little bit uncomfortable with the whole Trumpy vibe of thing, but I'm not quite sure I'm willing to go with Lamont for governor. I mean, he underperformed what seemed to be happening in these legislative races. So, and that's not that, you know, that's the big difference between 2014 and now is that Republicans have been picking up legislative seats and they lost ground last night in Connecticut. But there's still that sort of sense of, yeah, who do we want for governor? We're not sure.
So I'm not sure if it's that independent voters are saying, I don't want a Democrat in that seat, or they're saying, I don't want that Democrat in the seat.
Yeah.
And I think it says a lot about the candidates that are running as Dems and Republicans. I think it says a lot about the fact that you're seeing third-party candidates enter these races and, you know, change the narrative, even if they don't have a shot at winning. And it's why I think it is a conversation that the parties are going to have. No one was really excited about either of the candidates on the ballot last night. And what will that mean in order to govern, not just get elected?
It seems pretty clear that Mark Boughton or Steve Obsitnik would have won the election last night based on what we've seen in the way the campaign carried out. And that's something the Republicans have to obviously think about. Part of it, again, is the structure and the way the primary system works. But there's the state might have been better off with that, with a more balanced government.
Since we've been talking an awful lot about opening things up, open primaries next time around, the Republican Party used to do this. Did they say, look, this system in Connecticut, maybe at the national level it's what we want. It's the sort of race to the right. But on the Connecticut side, do we really want a primary that's going to get us a potentially unelectable candidate when you could have a more moderate Republican?
This is a state that can't get absentee balloting without voting without an excuse, for crying out loud. We're not going to get open primaries in this next 5 years.
Well, I think one lesson from last night, so we had these two ballot measures that were amendments, which is kind of the only thing that you can really do as a ballot measure statewide here. And I do think that ultimately the change may have to come that way. I think it's very hard for the legislature, for some reason, to embrace these kinds of reforms. And if you look across the country where they do have ballot initiatives, there were some massive voting reform packages. Michigan probably had the most comprehensive one that was up last night. That may be the way the change has to come. First of all, some of the changes might require a constitutional amendment anyway. I have to go back and read the Constitution and see what it says about what happens on Election Day. But I do think, anyway, it may just have to come from voter pressure. I don't think the people who are holding the offices right now are the ones who are going to engender change. The Secretary of State was on the air this morning on our station saying to Diane Orson that I think she's talking about the so-called no-fault absentee ballot. So that's absentee ballot where you don't have to provide
the
excuse.
That's the one, yeah, that's right.
Which is would be sort of Connecticut's somewhat limp version of early voting, I guess. But, I mean, if you want something more than that, I think ultimately it's got to come from the grassroots.
So we saw that in Florida last night with Amendment 4, where you will now have 1 million people in that state who can potentially vote again because the state struck down felon disenfranchisement laws. And I think that is the way that you make a bold move to really commit to protecting the ballot and not just tinkering with the margins to make it easier for people who would already vote anyway.
I just want to say, though, I was watching that Florida result all night, and it was so typically Florida in the way that it set up next to handpicked candidates for Senate and handpicked candidates for governor by Donald Trump, mm-hmm. Getting elected by narrow margins, mm-hmm. to be sure, but both winning these very close races. And on the other hand, Floridians saying, but we really want to be able to give the vote back to people who've been in prison.
Exactly. We don't like the racists in our public policy, but we're okay with the racists in the governor's mansion in Florida.
Let's not forget that Connecticut is the powder keg nexus of idle multimillionaires and the effects of Citizens United, such that money really did a lot more talking this year than I think a lot of people would be comfortable
with. But you just
said,
Danny, they're all going to leave. They're going to go to Florida. They'll go run races down there.
We make our own billionaires. Remember, under Lamont, look at that. Under Malloy.
You're already blaming him.
Oh, yeah. Connecticut went from having 9 billionaires to 17, even though 4 left.
I want to get to a couple quick phone calls.
I hope you get texted now.
Because people are calling about some of the things they saw yesterday. I want to quickly get to Kate in Hartford. Hey, Kate, thanks for holding on.
Hi, yeah. I live here in Hartford. I live in the west end of Hartford.
Yeah.
And I vote at the seminary. And when I got there was a woman coming out saying that they weren't telling people to look at the back of the ballot. There was a big red, I think, on the side, check the back of the ballot, but people were not looking. And my husband didn't look. He said that he went in. He's like, I didn't know there was something on the back because they put the questions on the front where the governor was. He didn't think to flip it over, he said. So that's just my comment. And then I spoke to other people that it was like 50% of people were looking to the back and 50% weren't.
Yeah, first of all, thank you very much for that. We heard some of that last night. The Hartford ballot looks different, obviously, than the ballots in other towns. There's different questions. There's a different arrangement of people on that ballot. Some get handed to you, Kalila, in little manila envelopes so that nobody else can see them. Some get handed to you in my town in Winsted with nothing because they're gigantic. They wanted to put everything on the front, but it was like, I don't know, it was like a placemat at a Denny's or something that I'm carrying around. And if you'd gotten it wet, it would have been a problem. But we don't have any sort of consistency, and we don't have someone, a friendly volunteer, who hands you the ballot every single time and says, by the way, check the back.
Where are our community and civic organizations in this discussion, right? We know the parties don't have a lot of incentive to tell people to flip the ballot, even though some of them did it at the last minute. But to even let people know what these issues are about so that they know, yes, I need to vote, but I also know for what I'm voting. And maybe if we're going to continue to have these placemats, we can solve our budget crisis by having, you know, Bounty be the official sponsor of Connecticut ballots. And we can put a little logo that says Ballots by Bounty. They can pay for that. We can keep them dry, and we can actually make some money for our state.
Don't give them any
idea. A picture of Michelle Cronin from Waterbury.
If they do that, I want credit for that.
I don't know who you need to go on a road trip with, Steve Obsitnik or Michelle Cronin, but you and them need to take a long drive somewhere. I just want to say, look, the Harper Current is a very cranky, but I think kind of understandably cranky editorial today about why does it take so long to get these results in? And they talk specifically about the registrar system. You want to fix something? I mean, I'm not going to endear myself to registrars. It's insane, though. We have almost 340 civic officials, because you got to have 2, maybe 3 sometimes. You know, I mean, we just don't need this. This is not a good system. It's a recipe for confusion. You have too many cooks. They have too many different ideas of how to make the broth or what's in the broth. And so, yeah, I mean, it's inexcusable that somebody walks into a polling place where there's a two-sided ballot and is not informed or alerted to a big red sign. And, of course, the other problem is there's no standardization. West Hartford didn't have a two-sided ballot because we didn't have ballot questions. You know, the only way to fix it, I'm sorry, is to break the hold of the registrars. There's your constitutional amendment.
Accountability.
Yeah, either that or you have to say to the local election officials, you know, if the following things don't happen, if you don't have this laminated card up here, you're liable for fines, and we, the state, will make no attempt to defend you whatsoever, blah, blah, blah. I mean, you have to scare the crap out of them so that they do their jobs more consistently. There are some fine registrars out there. They're not all terrible or anything like that, but it's too inconsistent. So either get rid of them or scare the bejesus out of them.
Okay, so we have scaring the bejesus out of registrars or maybe firing them. We have putting ads on the ballots to help pay for the entire system. Danny, your solution?
My solution is to just stay the course, and let's realize that in the pouring rain, we had 65% turnout in Connecticut. And let's stop a little bit for a second, just like we're going to give the Democrats a little 6 or 8 week honeymoon, and say, let's celebrate that fact. Mm-hmm. We had one of the highest turnouts in the country in the pouring rain. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we had a few problems, but you know, more or less, it's like an NBA replay. You know, they take 5 minutes, but when it comes out, it's a...
You know, but listen, if every NBA playoff game went to the courts, not the basketball courts, mm-hmm. but the courts, people would lose confidence in the NBA. We've had 3 gubernatorial cycles here where the courts got involved on Election Day. That is a recipe for undermining confidence in our voting system.
That replay that took 6 minutes between LeBron James and KD last year, it was inexcusable.
That's an outlier.
Okay, let's just turn quickly to Tim, who's in Westville in New Haven. What are you seeing, Tim, and what did you see yesterday?
Hey, folks. It was an exciting day. I'm calling from the 25th Ward in Westville, where not everything is Mark Oppenheimer's fault.
yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Well, we'll get to that. But I think you got to this while I was talking to your screener, but I just don't understand why our state can't do early voting. If we're going to say that voter suppression is a problem nationwide as a blue state, we really ought to fix that. Because, yeah, you may say turnout was great. It would have been a lot better if people could have voted in the days, the weekend before yesterday. So I only caught a part of your Denise Merrill conversation because, or parts of multiple conversations with her over the past couple of days, because it's so hard to listen to a WNPR on the stream, which I've complained about before.
Oh,
but,
no.
She should be given a hard time about this. Does it have to be an amendment? What's the deal?
Let me turn this over to Kalila. This is great. I'm proposing changes to our entire electoral system, and we can't even get a stream that Tim can listen to in Westville. But anyway, Kalila, his thoughts?
So I'm a fan of the 25th Ward. Just wanted to throw that out there. New Haven doesn't get enough credit. Yeah, I think that this is the opportunity. I've heard the Secretary of State talking about automatic registration, where you would have to opt out as opposed to opting in, and how that would help young people and some unaffiliated voters as well. I think having multiple days for people to go, especially in a state where transportation is an issue, in a state where people have to work and don't have that flexibility of time or being independently wealthy to do whatever you want to do, it would affirm the ability to do that. It would avoid some of these election day challenges that we see. But I also think democracy should be in the hands of the people, not in the hands of the courts.
Yeah.
And this would be a way to address that.
Can I give out Danny's cell phone number on the air so he can get the text? I'm getting texts that are meant for him.
Let's go quickly to Michael and Meriden. Hey, Michael.
Hi. I think that yesterday's turnout and the way that the numbers played out, I think it's a good example of how we might change the voting system to a ranked voting. I know you guys have talked about in the past, you know, being able to pick your first choice, second choice, and so on. That way, the independent and unaffiliated voters don't have as much of a, I guess you could say, negative impact on the way it plays out. So
well,
I just wanted to comment on that.
Well, first of all, thank you very much. I was looking at Danny Haar because with everything else we've proposed, we haven't talked about ranked choice voting. It was tried last night for the first time in the state of Maine. It wasn't in the gubernatorial race or any of the statewide races, but it was used in the federal races. And actually, what's interesting, a very, very close second congressional district race in Maine coming down to the wire, in part because of ranked choice voting. The idea is you get a chance to choose number one and number two. So let's say, Danny, you show up yesterday and you really don't like either the Republican or the Democrat. You think Oz Griebel's your guy, but you're able to vote for Ned Lamont second. All of a sudden, that helps you get a little closer to sorting out what the true feeling of the electorate is. What do you think?
I know I didn't get enough sleep, but I'm still, my head hurts from this. The only solution I can think of as a counter to that is staggered voting over the years, so that if you decide I'm going to sit this one out so that I can vote twice in 2022, maybe that'll be the solution.
Let me just say one thing about this. I think the problem here is Back to what Kalila was saying, you know, you got to pick a couple of ways to solve this problem and go with them. You can't have everything be on the table because then nothing's on the table. So, you know, if we're going to do, say, automatic registration plus early voting, you know, and just go that way. But you can't also do ranked choice and a Hogwarts sorting hat and, you know, five different other things.
Ranked choice voting, Kalila?
I mean, you know, go Hogwarts. The one thing that I will say is that whether we do our current system or ranked choice voting, we have to address the candidates that can afford to run in this state. And if not, we will always be choosing people who don't represent the people that they have to serve. In a state where the cost of running is so high because of Citizens United, where money can flood in and you have to be independently wealthy in order to have a chance in this state, that says a lot about voter morale and about getting people in office who represent the diversity of those interests.
Kalila Brown-Dean is an associate professor of political science at Quinnipiac University. Dan Haar is editor and columnist at Hearst Connecticut Media. Colin McEnroe hosts the aptly named Colin McEnroe Show on Connecticut Public Radio. When we come back, we're going to be talking about a little bit of history in the Connecticut 5th District race. Maybe get to some more of your phone calls as well here on The Wheelhouse on the day after Election Day 2018. This is The Wheelhouse. I'm John Dankosky. We're talking about the big results from last night. Ned Lamont will be the next governor of the state of Connecticut. He gave a brief statement in which he said, "I'm humbled and I want every resident to know how grateful I am for this extraordinary honor. I will work every day, honestly and thoughtfully, to move the state forward and be a champion for Connecticut." Earlier, Bob Stefanowski had conceded to Ned Lamont a very, very close race once again. Once again, a race, as we've been saying throughout the course of this program, that came down to what happened in a city that wasn't able to necessarily count its votes the right way. Last night, it was New Haven. In the past, it's been Hartford or Bridgeport. So probably more on that in the future. Let's talk about another race that is a big inspiration to an awful lot of people. Johanna Hayes won in the 5th Congressional District. She will be the first African-American woman to ever serve in Connecticut, one of two African-American women to be elected last night in the states of New England. Here's what she told some of her supporters last night.
Over 220,000 votes were cast in this. Over 225 votes. And I told you, your vote is your voice. Your vote is your voice. And you use your vote. And you use your voice to vote for me on not one line, but two lines, on the Democratic line and on the working families line. And you said, we are not having it.
That's Johanna Hayes last night. So, Kalila Brown-Dean, a lot of things to talk about here. First of all, this is an extraordinary personal story. And if you listen to the national commentary from last night with a number of women of color winning congressional seats for the first time, I think that there's a tendency to want to say this is part of a wave and these are all things that are happening the same way all across the country. But these are all very unique, individual, different stories. And Johanna Hayes' story is a pretty special one.
Yeah, and it makes me so proud when I listen to her speech, because here is a woman who was a young single mother who graduated from a community college and became an educator. That's the story that I think we need to tell. So while some people were offended that she dare say Congress should look like us, I think it says a lot about their own views that that was offensive to them. Congress should look like working class people who have a commitment to our country and are willing to sacrifice to make it happen. That's the Congress we want to see. And I think we're going to see that not just in Johanna Hayes, but in people like Ilhan Omar coming out of Minnesota, like Deb Haaland coming out of New Mexico. This is going to make a difference, not just for the institution of Congress. And I want to be clear, Congress is the way it is for a reason, right? But it's also going to bring new voices to the table that's not just about identity, but it's also about substantive policy and their ability to change the conversation.
And it's not just about identity. This is an interesting conversation I've had with a number of Democrats, including some who weren't necessarily sure that she was ready to take the step and to get into Congress. Mm-hmm. While she hasn't been a politician, before, and while she may not have a grasp of some of the things necessarily on day one that a congressperson would have, when you've been an educator in public schools, my sense is that you probably learned a little bit about things like how children and parents get together, the struggles that working parents face, opioid addiction, mm-hmm. the things that people struggle with in America right now. Public school teachers are pretty much on the front lines every day, it would seem.
Who understands how a bureaucracy works or does not work better than a public school educator who knows that they walk into the classroom every day, and although others think their mission is to simply teach kids how to read and how to write, they have to deal with the whole child and understanding if there's instability in the home and the community, it affects the classroom. That is the perspective. You can teach people the fine points about the committee system and how seniority works and, you know, where you want to stay and where you don't. You'll have a good staff to do that. But the fundamental principle of what you're bringing to Congress based on your experience and your commitment, that can't be taught.
I think it comes down to, in terms of getting people elected, it still comes down to money and access to existing power. And in this case, Johanna Hayes had the tacit and initially covert support of Senator Murphy. And so it may not be such a great triumph of identity politics and who she is as much as it is that she had access to money and power early on.
I think it undermines her to say that it was because she rode on having Chris Murphy as sort
that.
Of her.
No, I didn't say that.
I think her access to resources came from grassroots organizations around the country like Higher Heights for America that said, we are committed to supporting African-American women to run for office. Was Chris Murphy and his influence a factor? Of course. But I think that it really undermines the point that women, particularly women of color around this country, won because they took the grassroots approach that too many candidates overlook to think, I can just buy my way in. You go teach full-time during the day and then go knock doors, that says something about your candidacy.
I didn't say that she got there because of what happened. What I said was it's still a commentary on the system that she needed that too.
Colin?
Yeah, I don't know. In baseball, there's this statistic, wins above replacement value, which I've never entirely understood. But put some generic Democrat on that ticket who's not Johanna Hayes and see how that person does. It's a much closer election. Maybe the Democrat wins, but it's a much closer election. At a certain point, Johanna Hayes, with her ability to raise money from the grassroots all over this country, she kind of went viral. Certain candidates win. Some candidates seem like they're heading towards being on a Wheaties box or a Ben & Jerry's flavor or something like that. She's more in that latter category. She says a ton of charisma. You know, the minute you put her on the ballot, you've got a huge advantage in who she is. Give some other generic candidate the same money and access to power, they don't do as well. I just quickly, before we run out of time,
sure,
want to say that it might be easy to forget. The other thing that happened last night is with the House nationally flipping, John Larson becomes a more important person. Rosa DeLauro becomes a more important person. Jim Himes becomes a more important person. Joe Courtney becomes a more important person. They've been there a long time. They have a lot of connections. Larson's had a very high-ranking leadership role. The other ones have important committee roles, particularly if we get into some of these investigative committees and stuff like that. The Democratic Connecticut delegation is going to be really, really well placed to play a major role in the guidance of the Congress in the next few years.
Yeah, well, particularly since you have Ways and Means, Intelligence, and Armed Services with those Himes, Larson, and Courtney.
So more power for Democrats in Congress. And once again, it's a Democratic state, Kalila. A lot of people didn't want that, right? They wanted split government. They wanted maybe some checks and balances. This certainly seems to be what we want at the national level. Does Connecticut benefit from having all of its elected representatives going to Washington, all of its top elected officials statewide, all being Democrats and both houses of the legislature?
I think time will tell. There should be no excuse not to pass something that is substantive that will fundamentally change the quality of life for people in our state. And if Democrats cannot do that by having all of those positions, then they don't deserve to continue governing.
Democrats win bragging rights back from Hawaii, but they have to act like new style Democrats that hear what the other side is saying.
Colin, what do you think about this?
Well, first of all, I mean, I think the big story out of last night in Connecticut was, in fact, this incredible reversal within the legislature, within the state legislature. I think the, you know, in the days ahead, that's the thing that we're going to see play out. And some of these new people coming in may be very exciting.
I want to say congratulations to all the people who won last night. I also want to say congratulations to all the people who got involved in this system and who ran, people who we haven't gotten a chance to talk about. I want to thank all the people who stood out in the rain and got wet and maybe got their ballots wet to make sure that they could vote yesterday. And I want to thank the people who put together our show for us. In the show last night, Scott Breedy, Katie Talarski, Kyan Wolf, Panina Beattie, Carlos Mejia, so many others. The cameras of CTN, the Connecticut Network, were here as well today. And I want to thank our friend Danny Haar, editor and columnist at Hearst Connecticut Media. Thanks so much, Dan.
Thank you for having me.
And Kalila Brown-Dean, associate professor of political science at Quinnipiac University. Thank you, Kalila.
Thank you, John.
And thanks to Colin McEnroe, the host of the Colin McEnroe Show. Thank you, Colin.
Thank you.
Well, this is it for the Wheelhouse on this day after Election Day edition. We're all going to get some sleep, and we'll be back next week.